People who like this franchise have a really hard time understanding why others find it stupid and washed up. People who find it stupid and washed up have a really hard time understanding why people like this franchise. People only dislike Sonic so much because the Game Grumps made it cool to hate. People only like the adventure games because of nostalgia. People only hate on the Sonic franchise because of a few bad apples. People only defend the series because they're a bunch of sheep who don't know when they're playing a bad game. People only dislike it because the presentation makes them think it's kids' stuff. Personally, I'm not gonna say any of these are unequivocally true or false, but there are a lot of people who will. I honestly don't care in the least if you hate or love this franchise, but the amount of people who care deeply is surprising. As most anyone can attest to, narrow-minded arguments are the norm for internet discussion. On all sides of internet debate, people are stupid. Not to say that all people are stupid, but there are always people who are stupid, sometimes. Oddly enough, when it comes to attacking and defending Sonic games, the number of people who are stupid, sometimes, is high. These arguments, made up of only, all, and never, are absolutist, oversimplifying, but they're pretty common amongst debates. This is just the way things are when discourse takes place alone in a room, sending messages to other people alone in their rooms. Now, some of these theories are more outrageous than others, but most people who argue against or for Sonic's righteousness do so with the mindset that there is this one, all-encompassing, simple reason to why the franchise is terrible or good, and only one reason. People often have troubles grasping why the other side feels different from them, so much so that the only explanation to why others feel this way must be some strange social construct that conjured the hatred. And for the other side, many people who dislike the franchise have so little of an idea as to why people like it that they assume some unprecedented nostalgic brainwashing must be at play, or that the fandom is only driven by the character design and their own fictitious ideas. This theory of there being some undiscovered yet obvious single reason to the controversies of this franchise is an idea that I see much less often in other gaming topics. In all the fandoms and anti-fandoms that I've seen firsthand within gaming, I've never seen as much polarization, stubbornness, and conspiracy theorization than in the topic of Sonic. For example, very few people would argue that you only like Mario Sunshine because you played it as a toddler. Despite the game being also mildly controversial, people don't tend to make massive forums trying to convince you that it was never good, but they will with Sonic's Dreamcast entries. In the same vein, not many people will engage in a heated debate on the reasons that you should hate the Legend of Spyro trilogy despite its broadly agreed inferiority to the originals. Not many people today really seem to care what Mario games you like, what Spyro trilogy you prefer, what Star Fox gameplay style you think is best. There are debates about these topics for sure, and strong opinions on them occasionally, but these debates lost their relevance 5, 10, 15 years ago. But not Sonic opinions, that's where boys become bullies or revert to infants, and by the boys I mean nearly everybody who's ever played a video game, because for whatever reason Sonic seems to be the discussion that almost everybody takes a stance on. This includes a vast amount of people who, by all logic and reasoning, should not have an opinion on it. Loads of people who haven't played a Sonic entry since early 2001 will still rant about the state of the franchise and where they think it went wrong. People whose only experience with the lore was watching an early Sonic cartoon will still rave about it being their favorite media universe. Middle-aged men and women, but mostly men, who haven't played a single game beyond the original trilogy and Knuckles, yes, still have strong opinions on the state of this. Everybody cares. Trends suggest that people care more about Sonic than about franchises with bigger followings. They consistently care more about debating Sonic than they do about a relevant new release. While most fade into being forgotten in a month, Sonic arguments have spanned decades. People even care to tell their Sonic opinions more than their stances on well-known tales of historical failure. The title is what it is for a reason. Strong opinion plus Sonic equals mass outrage, and mass outrage equals clicks. It's not new, its games aren't always liked, it's not exclusive to any console or platform, it's completely inoffensive in and of itself, and some would argue that it's not even especially unique in today's market. In fact, some might say it has all the qualities of a franchise that is irrelevant old news. So why is it that in people who debate Sonic the Hedgehog you will find some of the most offensive, narrow-minded, absolutist, angry, loyal, argumentative, loud people in online discourse? And why are there so many of them? The franchise isn't quite as relevant in the gaming industry as it used to be, but for whatever reason, people still think it is. It's not something that should commonly be on people's minds, but it is. In all its main series entries, Sonic hasn't even had a T-rated title, but it's apparently one of the most offensive, controversial gaming topics of the past 30 years. Note that I'm talking about Sonic's presence in the gaming world, not just in the media as a whole. These opinions apply to before the movie came out and caused such a boost in Sonic's popularity. So why does Sonic the franchise get the special treatment of occupying the minds of so many people? There are some good reasons as to why, they just don't get discussed much because people are too busy arguing over whether or not Sonic's arms should be blue or if they should bring back Zavok as a playable character in the next spin-off. Now don't get me wrong, these are important topics for sure, And the answer is no. People don't want to play a Zafox Sega. Stop acting like he's the best thing you've done in the past 10 years. But let's look at the less important mystery, the unprecedented cult following of Sonic Media. There's a lot more to this issue than people tend to realize. You could say human nature tends to attract people to the Sonic franchise because people crave controversy. We naturally want to be a part of a team, and there can only be teams where there are divides. Over the course of 30 years, Sega has supplied a lot of divides with their Sonic endeavors. The dividing topics began in the 90s with sudden changes to the original gameplay style that nobody wanted to change. Then there was an odd choice for a first 3D title, the eventual main 3D titles being loved and then questioned decades later. The changes in branding, style, characters, and settings, reboots, notorious failures, budget, and production issues. A division of voice actors, characters being used and then thrown away, and sometimes just failures to make good content. All these things that the Sonic franchise is notorious for lead the franchise to be diverse and divisive. Now, listing all these things paints Sonic the franchise in a pretty bad light, and ignore all of the loved aspects of its lifetime, but these issues are what it's known for to the outside community. To an outsider who consumes Sonic opinions on a surface level, you'll know this franchise as a laughing stock. This could be what makes people unable to comprehend why some consider themselves Sonic fans, but I have no answer on that specifically. What I do know is most people know about and see the controversial aspects of Sonic, and with how many controversies there are, diverse opinions run rampant. Its history of inconsistency is what attracts and conjures so many people to argue and debate the good and the bad more than that of other franchises. The active fans have made a mission to educate the masses on the lesser discussed media that they enjoy in Sonic, and the anti-fans have a constant need to question why Sonic fans support a series that has, in their eyes, given them little to love. It's an endless battle between those who consider Sonic to have too many failures to support and those who have found reasons to support it, taking it up on themselves to educate or argue in its defense. This theory of controversy attracting more argumentative people than most discussion groups is what I would attribute the surprisingly passionate debates to, but why so many people engage in these debates is a whole nother topic. I have a theory that has something to do with how much the Sonic franchise has changed over a large course of time, and here's my reasoning behind that. Sonic the series has taken so many forms and has been around for so long that you're bound to have discovered something that fits your own personal tastes. You don't like the 2D platforming, you can try the 3D. You can try different styles of 3D. You can try Drift, Adventure, 2.5D, Puzzle, Mobile, Mario 3D World, Motion Controls, RPG, Racing, Trick Racing, Kart Racing, Kart Racing, slightly different Kart Racing, etc. Whatever you may have liked, there were so many different eras and styles of Sonic games that most people had a good chance to have been introduced to one in particular, often securing your alliance with whatever Sonic you happen to grow fond of. The more styles and choices, the higher the odds are that someone will latch on to one or the other. To contrast this, Mario has a few different styles and eras for sure, 2D games and 3D games, but fewer subsections within them. I'd say there really isn't much of a gameplay change between Mario 64 to Galaxy to Odyssey. It's the same gameplay. It's got different twists and gimmicks, but it's generally the same. It almost always controls the same. Most people who like the originals will still enjoy the 2.5D platformers, and same for the fans of the classic 3D titles. Yes, there are plenty of spin-offs, but you can always tell when a Mario game isn't a full-fledged main series entry. With Sonic, it's not always so obvious. There's simply more consistency between Nintendo titles, fewer divides, fewer opportunities to separate fans into categories. On one hand, this isn't a very positive aspect for Sega, but on the other, having a very diverse style of games attracts a larger, diverse crowd. Even though most people can enjoy 3D Mario games, if you don't, then Mario doesn't have that much more to offer you. If you don't like Sonic Adventure, you might still like Swordplay Sonic, Advanced Sonic, Battle Sonic, Heroes Sonic, etc. Whether you think they're good critically or not, it might just fit the style of games that you want to play. This might not be great for uniting fandoms in the long term, but it's likely why Sonic is as well known as it is. So controversiality explains the strong-headedness among Sonic debates. Diversity and inconsistency could be the reason behind it having such a massive presence among gaming, but is it really that impressive nowadays for a gaming mascot to be known to gamers? Not so much. But most people I know what Sonic is, even if they've never experienced any of its media. And believe it or not, I do have interactions with people once in a while who don't play video games. Sonic is known not just in gaming, but known in media in general, and the reasoning behind that is much more about the tide of trends than it is about human tendencies like these other topics. If Sega has done one thing consistently well with Sonic, it's injecting him into every media they can. Multiple TV series, obscene amounts of merchandise, movies, an extensive comic universe, endless spin-offs, advertising cameos, food and drink, the list goes on. I can't even say Mario has more presence outside of his video games, although that's a debatable argument to make. Now, as much as I hate to mention this, and it really does age the video by about 50%, meme culture is also kind of important to the notoriety of a series. Though I see Sonic as having a lot more comedically marketable properties for this kind of thing, such as cartoons, cutscenes, gameplay aspects, and advertisements, it doesn't really dominate the sphere as much as something like Mario or Pokemon. And especially not Mario, considering apparently it's the funniest thing in the world to just take any regular old clip from real life and put the Mario aesthetic over it. It's like, okay, this is the same video as it used to be. You just happen to put familiar sounds and imagery over it. It doesn't make it any funnier. It's the same thing with Minecraft. Why is everybody just taking random meme clips and making it Minecraft-oriented? It doesn't make it any funnier, it just makes it different. But anyway, I thought this was worth mentioning. Or maybe I just wanted to complain about memes for a minute. Rest in peace any seriousness that people took this video for. To add on to this aspect of the general public finding Sonic trendable, he also has a pretty strong presence specifically in YouTube, one of the most driving forces of fame today. YouTube always has channels dedicated to various properties, ranging from gaming, to music, to movies, but each genre has its own subsections as well. In gaming, you have notorious Call of Duty channels, Smash Bros. Channels, Overwatch, Nintendo Simulator, etc. There are channels and mini-communities dedicated to pretty much every topic that you might be into. But Sonic channels tend to be a special breed in terms of YouTube communities. To randomly dive into my own personal investment in this topic, I was without a doubt a part of this community, and to many people who have been with me for a long time, I still am. I mean, making this very video is proof of that. Years ago, I had a mostly undisturbed lineup of Sonic reviews, gameplay videos, and essay videos, and I incidentally got to see firsthand just how much Sonic topics drive an audience compared to other franchises. For whatever reason, Sonic title and thumbnail just drives viewers more than Mario, Star Fox, Spyro, other interests that I would make videos on. Don't get me wrong, these topics can get plenty of traction if they're marketed correctly and done right, and there are many channels who thrive off them, no doubt. But I think the controversial history of Sonic and the vast diversity of opinions and the emotionally invested fans cause Sonic videos to just have a bit of an edge over other topics. And I think this is the reason behind the unusually strong Sonic audience on YouTube. As a note on my personal experience with running a channel that houses so many Sonic fans and opinions, I want to say that I am always impressed by my own personal audience in the Sonic-related content. For how toxic the community can be, I have only ever met friendly, polite debates over the series in my own comment sections. The audience that I've grown, somewhat primarily from Sonic content, is one that I'm pretty proud of and happy to house. They're all very understanding and welcoming to me, and I know it's just an anecdotal situation and possibly a rare one if that. Other SonicTubers have other experiences. I quite like mine, but everyone has their own crowd, and some are better than others. But I just wanted to note that and say that I'm not necessarily referring to people who watch my videos when I say that the fandom is toxic or divisive, etc. Anyway, back to the topic at hand. The YouTube community definitely helps keep Sonic trendy and relevant, and it tends to be the gathering place of most Sonic fans who still have interest in the franchise. It keeps a lot of the Sonic social media presence strong, and has a heavy impact on opinion trends. This leads me to the next theory in the wonders of the Sonic fandom, the idea that Sega is heavily influenced by said social media users. Does the sometimes toxic fanbase cause Sega to make poor decisions when it comes to Sonic games, comics, TV shows, etc.? Does it influence positive change? Does it even influence them at all? It's actually a very common question, and we'll need to start with dissecting the relationship Sega has with the Sonic fandom and their personal involvement in the community. To explore this idea, I'd like to talk a bit about my own relationship with Sega, with other Sonic YouTubers, and with my own audience, which inevitably consists of many Sonic fans and anti-fans. I tend to keep to myself when it comes to other YouTubers. I rarely collab, associate, or talk behind the scenes, or publicly, with any other content creators much at all. It's just my way of using the internet. I've done a handful of video cameos, I've casually chatted in DMs with a few people whose content I enjoy. I engage in discussion on the Sonic Twitter community here and there, and I'm sure I'll do all these things more in the future, but that's about it. Compared to others, I don't really do much. This isn't due to not liking anyone or not knowing anyone, it just happens to be how I use the internet. I'm very content watching people's careers from a distance and focusing on my own content. So with that in mind, here's the extent of my own knowledge on Sega's relationship of the Sonic social media. Sometimes they send us content creators cool care packages and promotion of a new game. Sometimes the staff follows us on Twitter, and sometimes they'll cheer us on for things like charity events or fan-made content. They've always had an open, welcoming approach to fan games, animations, and events, unlike certain other companies I know of, and even sometimes make internet-exclusive content that you can view for free. It also isn't rare for Sega to hire people who were fans of Sonic to help work on games, comics, and other Sonic-related projects. They are surprisingly involved with the Sonic social media crowd, I will say, and especially more so than most franchises of this stature. I give them a lot of credit for that. They have a very forwards-thinking approach to using the internet to get more involved with the consumers, and it gives the community a sense of importance and worth. Now, with such a strong relationship with fans, people wonder just how much power the Sonic fan community holds in terms of influencing Sega's decisions. Many people believe that Sega has become too personal and involved with their own fandom, one that can be seen as divisive, indecisive, toxic. The theory is that listening too much to the sporadic fans is what leads to having constant changes in gameplay, style, development times. Although I do get this logic, there's only two specific scenarios that might suggest this to be true, and I'll go over them both now. The first was in the development of the Sonic movie. We all know the backlash the film's trailer was met with, and every single design that was leaked over the course of 7 years. After the hissy fit, the film's director tweeted that they would be changing a bunch of stuff and pushing the movie back. A clear example of listening to fans, but Fowler doesn't work for Sega primarily, and the movie was being produced by several companies, only one of which I think is actually owned by Sega. I think it was more a case of Paramount and the director wanting to please fans than it was an example of Sega being influenced by the fandom, but who knows? Not a direct indication of either way. The only other instance of fans possibly influencing Sega that I'm aware of was their decisions to take more time to make Sonic games after Forces. Giving themselves more time to develop games has been a request of fans for many years, and rightfully so, but I don't think it's a clear example of Sega being an influenceable company. This sort of thing is fairly common in game development for plenty of different companies, and I don't see it as being fan pandering as much as just a smart business decision. Both the movie scenario and the dev time reveal are the most common examples I see to the theory that Sega is persuaded by fans, and neither of them directly assures that's actually the case. The two scenarios are just smart decisions, and any company would probably make them, and one might not have even been decided by Sega themselves. I do think Sega listens to their community more than other companies, and it definitely mingles with them more, but I think the overall decisions they make have very little to do with things like argument forums or specific community ideas. We need to make a clear distinction between the natural influence that any fandom has on its base, and a fandom having direct control over that base. The distinction isn't huge, but any company that wants to sell a product is going to listen to their consumers to some extent. COD puts out early access versions of their games to get feedback from players, Nintendo has to pay attention to demand for bug fixes and balance changes in Smash Bros. There's always an aspect of players controlling the development of games that they're being sold, but honestly, I don't think it was the Sonic fans wanting a presentation change that caused Sega to make Sonic Boom. I don't think it was the complaining of classic fans that brought about Sonic 4 or Mania. I don't think it was the mass amount of fans making their own original fan characters that made Sega want to put in a character creation aspect in Sonic Forces. These are most likely just a matter of following trends, rebranding for an excitement boost in marketing, and just having a new idea for a story/gameplay aspect. I could be wrong, and I'm sure there's multiple reasons behind all of these, but I just haven't seen proof that fans have a direct influence on the big things. I'm sure they're taken into account, I'm sure they do listen to fans, as most companies do, but until I hear a more convincing scenario, I just don't think they make company decisions solely based on what fans are saying. At this point, I've covered every major reason I'm aware of behind Sonic's unprecedented notoriety and relevance. I don't think there is one end-all secret as to why this franchise is so popular, loved, hated, speculated, discussed, whatever. There isn't some hidden voodoo causing sheep to mass hate on something that they sometimes haven't even experienced for themselves. It's a mixture of many different ingredients that make up the history of why people find it so interesting to debate, so enjoyable to experience, so laughable to critique, and everything in between. I believe the inconsistency brings about the diversity of opinions. Its notorious highs and unprecedented lows lead to its constant relevance, and its fans tend to keep the discussion moving forward no matter what the state of the franchise may be in. To once again stoop so low as to give my own opinion, I am a fan of the Sonic franchise due to a variety of life experiences and personal preferences. And it's just general happenstance that I like it. SA2 was one of the first games that I ever saw played in person before having any video games of my own. Its radical, early 2000s cool dude vibes drew me in as a kid, and since then I've grown to love the universe, the characters, and different experiences that the series has to offer. Just the random happenstance of finding one game endearing led me to eventually playing every nook and cranny of the franchise, and not everybody will have the same experience that I did, but I happen to have grown fond of the Sonic franchise for more reasons than I even know. Lately, there have been discussions among fans saying they're losing interest in the Sonic franchise due to a lack of good content. I get that, it's a perfectly valid reason, but I've seen a good chunk of people say specifically, "If we don't get a good game soon, I'm gonna stop being a Sonic fan, or I'm gonna leave the franchise." For me, I like the games I like. For whatever reason, I like them. I'm not gonna stop liking the ones that I like just because Nintendo gives their fans more consistent content or better anniversary events. I'm not gonna stop saying that I like the franchise if they put out a certain number of bad games in the future. I'm not a fan of Sonic because I think it's going to put things out that I like. I'm a fan of something because it's given me a reason to like it in the past. My positive memories with the things that I like aren't going to vanish into thin air because maybe we're not getting something as good in the future. I like what I like because of what it is, not because of what it isn't, I mean. Obviously. Maybe you happen to like it, maybe you don't. But whatever your opinion is, there's probably a lot more reasons than you even know. And if you keep that in mind, you'll find that everyone else's opinions aren't nearly as outrageous as they seem. It can even help you find your own personal interests less surprising, or you might have less shame for liking what you like. If we can all just accept that happenstance is at play more than witchcraft causing people to like something, we might have more time to get our lives in order, or clean out our rooms or something, I don't know. So this has been me, hopefully not just regurgitating things that you've heard a million times before. Tune in next time when I make a 2-hour video debating the psychology behind our innate desire to achieve immortality. And if you think this video was lame because I didn't have many funnies, here's a funny sound I made with my face.